Sorry. I got him. Check the rest of the squad.
Hello, I'm General Pete Corelli. Our nation is currently being tested both at home and abroad. For our brave troops fighting overseas, this test is bringing profound sacrifices. Many of our men and women serving overseas are returning with serious injuries, including traumatic brain injury or TBI.
Okay, you know what unit you're in?
No.
Sometimes these injuries are obvious and they're quickly treated.
Okay, all right, that's all right. We're gonna get you squared away, Sergeant. Don't you worry about that.
Right. But often, brain injuries are not immediately visible. This makes them no less real. A concussion, clinically known as a mild traumatic brain injury, can be difficult to detect. The diagnostic challenge is widespread and not limited to the military. Football players, boxers, people who have been in car accidents, who have slipped and fallen, are all cases of people who may have sustained a TBI and need medical evaluation. Those who have been exposed to a potentially concussive event or believe they may have must be appropriately evaluated, treated, protected from future exposures, and if their condition warrants, sent for further evaluation and treatment. Due to the possible significant physical and mental impacts of concussion exposure, we now have protocols that mandate medical evaluation after specific events. The risk of TBI for service members has made this a priority for leadership. We believe that early and appropriate diagnosis, evaluation, and treatment will shorten the time it takes to return to duty or to the highest level of function possible. This applies to injuries during deployment and at home station. A TBI can affect the injured and their families long after the injury event. Most individuals who sustain concussion can expect a full recovery with no lasting mental or physical effects. The good news is that we are learning more and more about the brain and its ability to heal. With early identification and treatment, those with brain injuries can enjoy rich, full, and productive lives. Together, we can increase awareness, we can foster understanding, and we can help welcome those who have survived a brain injury back into our families, our units, our workplaces, and our communities. Thank you for your continued strong support.
I'm Lieutenant General Eric Schoemaker, the Army Surgeon General and the Commanding General of the Army Medical Command. A major objective of Army and DoD medicine is to develop the best process to evaluate and treat every service member involved in an event that may result in brain injury. The military health system and the VA, the Veterans Administration, provides state-of-the-art care from the point of injury through acute treatment and rehabilitation. The programs are centered on the soldier and the family, with an emphasis on primary care and case management. And as needed, other highly skilled professionals will be brought into your care. Traumatic brain injury, or TBI, is a disruption of brain function from a hit, a blow, or a jolt to the head, or a penetrating head injury that disrupts brain function. Traumatic brain injuries can range from mild injuries that are called concussions to severe and penetrating injuries. Mild traumatic brain injury, which the doctors and scientists call MTBI or mild TBI, is known by the general public as concussion. So when we talk about the spectrum of traumatic brain injuries, the most mild end of the scale is someone who's had a force or a blow to their head, which may have caused them to have an alteration in consciousness, where they might have felt like they got their bell rung or may have lost consciousness altogether, even for just a short time. This is the same type of concussion that athletes might have encountered when playing contact sports, youth sports, or riding a bicycle and having an accident. Traumatic brain injuries are overwhelmingly treatable. This is especially true for concussion. Receiving prompt care, regardless of severity, is key to returning to the highest function level possible. Working together, soldiers and family members affected by TBI can be confident they'll receive the world's finest treatment from our Department of Defense and Veterans Administration medical community.
The Defense and Veterans Brain Injury Center, or DVBIC, was created in 1992 by Congress. Because at that time, there weren't enough facilities throughout the DoD and VA focused on head injuries. We wanted to combine experts on TBI and work together to help all the services within the Department of Defense and the Veterans Affairs. Today, we collaborate even more and have 17 sites around the world working with brain-injured patients from each branch of the armed services, Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines, and veterans as well. This joint effort allows us to use the experts in every area of TBI, research, treatment, and clinical care, so we can offer the best and most up-to-date care and technology to our wounded warriors.
Hi, my name is Rock Cartwright with the Washington Redskins. I've had numerous experiences with mild TBI. The one that I mainly remember was against the New York Giants. I took a hit.
I mean, that was your first time you had a concussion?
Yeah, that was my first time.
I mean, what happened when you had a concussion?
Man, it was just like, I just got hit on kickoff return, and all I can remember is you know how when you hit a bell and it vibrate?
Right.
That's what my brain was doing, just vibrating, just shaking and shaking for like, I know for like 10, 15 minutes, it took me to get back to my normal self. Like, you know how it is when you go to the sideline, yeah. When your eyes be rolling in the back of your head, things like that. You know, my teammates were asking me, was I okay? And, you know, for 10 minutes there, I wasn't okay. And then they was asking me, what state were we in? What was my daughter's name? What was my parents' name? Where did I live? You know, all type of questions, just, you know, basic questions that you should always know that should be able to come out right off the top of your head. So it was an experience I'll never forget. And I remember days after, I still had headaches. Still had pain in the back of my neck, but I'm doing pretty good right now. I don't have any more effects from it.
Yeah, I know we kind of talking to the soldiers out there, you know, and a lot of times, you know, we want to be those tough guys. Like you say, you went back in, and I'm sure under any other circumstances that a regular person probably wouldn't be able to do any type of activity, let alone go back out there and play. So I'm saying, what could you tell the soldiers out there, man, in reference to the decisions and, you know, how should they go about it once they get it? Type of concussion, they want to be that tough guy there.
Well, I think personally, some of the side effects that you mentioned, some dizziness, you felt like you heard a bell, just like being a soldier, if you're in a situation where you not actually where the bombing happened, but have like some of the after effect of the hearing, you should get checked out because at the end of the day, you don't want to come back to the States and have those symptoms such as dizziness, headaches. Don't be so macho and take away from the consideration of your health, which is the most important thing.
Just get it checked out.
As leaders and fellow soldiers, we must be vigilant against attitudes or efforts minimizing the presence of concussive injury symptoms of a potentially wounded soldier. To maintain the fighting force, we need an open climate for assessment, identification, proper observation, and rest to facilitate rapid return to duty. This is particularly vital after a blast event. The following four events require mandatory medical evaluation and reporting of exposure of all involved personnel. 1, anyone in a vehicle associated with a blast event, collision, or rollover. 2, anyone within 50 meters of a blast, either inside or outside a building or vehicle. 3, anyone who sustains a direct blow to the head or experienced a loss of consciousness. And 4, command directed, which includes but is not limited to soldiers with repeated exposures or leader observations of a soldier's abnormal behavior. A 24-hour rest period is mandated for all personnel involved in one of these four events. The 24-hour rest period begins at the time of the event. Commanders may determine that mission requirements supersede individual service member welfare in certain circumstances. But this decision is determined at the commander's discretion. Each waiver will be documented in the required monthly report to the Joint Trauma Analysis and Prevention of Injury and Combat Program. Each of these four events represents the general foundation of our medical evaluation process. The size or magnitude of a concussive event could greatly expand the parameters. Vigilance by every soldier in reporting any of the following symptoms of an injury during the first 24 to 48 hours is critical. Headaches, vomiting, ears ringing, hearing loss, amnesia, altered consciousness, loss of consciousness, double vision, dizziness, sleep issues, or something feeling wrong or something that is not right. If any of these symptoms are seen, felt, or experienced, then soldiers should be evaluated or reevaluated by medical personnel. The acronym HEADS will help you remember this. H for headaches or vomiting. E for ears ringing. A for amnesia or altered loss of consciousness. D for double vision or dizziness. And S for something feeling wrong or something that is not right. Properly executed, this process will quickly identify soldiers with a concussion and ultimately return them to the fight.
We've made great strides in equipping our soldiers. One such example is the MRAP. Soldiers are resilient. They may be traveling along a roadway in theater in an MRAP and strike an IED. They emerge from the damaged MRAP, many times with no visible injuries. However, they may have experienced a concussive event, so it's important that they be medically evaluated prior to returning to duty. I cannot stress enough the importance of getting checked out. No matter how well you think you're protected by your personal protective equipment or your vehicle, be sure to get checked out if any of the mandatory criteria apply, or if you meet the protocol, or if something just doesn't seem right.
Me as a player rep on the team, I make sure that there's a guy that has a concussion, that he makes sure he goes through the proper steps, the right protocol to be able to go and get himself checked out, because these guys have families, they have lives to live. So I just want to say to you guys are going through the same things. You may have had a concussion, but you may not even know it. So the most important thing is, what is it going to hurt if you get it checked out? If there's nothing wrong, then fine, you can go and continue doing what you were doing, but you have to be accountable, you know, to your fellow soldier to make sure that he gets the proper help.
Unit leaders must be acutely aware of those individuals who have had repeated exposure to concussive events over the course of a deployment. Commanders and staff at all levels should track and consider the operational tempo and actions of these soldiers exposed to multiple or repeated concussive events. Commanders and unit leaders should consider periodic evaluation of these personnel to ensure that accumulated minor concussive events do not give rise to acute health-related problems. Examples of personnel potentially exposed to multiple or repeated concussive events include, but are not limited to, route clearance teams, EOD personnel, weapons intelligence teams, and counter IED team members. Recurrent concussions will be closely monitored and require a longer mandatory recovery period than the initial concussive event, depending on the number of incidents. Stricter restrictions will be placed on those soldiers for their protection.
Where do you think you're going?
We're wrangling up some Marines, Doc.
I don't think so. You had two MTBI incidents in the last 2 weeks. You're restricted to 5 for a week. After that, your battalion docs have to clear you for duty. Understand?
If two documented concussions have occurred within the past 12 months, return to duty is delayed for an additional 7 days following symptom resolution.
The symptoms are hard to spot, often shrugged off as a headache or being tired. Fact is, these are the telltale signs of MTBI.
If three or more documented concussions have occurred within the past 12 months, return to duty is delayed until a recurrent concussion evaluation has been completed and a plan of care established. All sports and other activities with risk of concussion are prohibited until the soldier is cleared. Commanders may impose more stringent requirements based on mission requirements and after consultation with medical personnel.
Prevention and mitigation of potential concussion is a leadership issue. Leaders must enforce use of protective equipment and encourage soldiers to seek evaluation if they think they may have sustained a concussion. Your support demonstrates strong leadership, lessens the stigma of seeking care for this common injury, and contributes to maintaining the fighting force. This support needs to permeate the entire organization, from the senior leaders to the first line supervisors. Leaders at all levels must ensure that soldiers suspected of possible concussive injury are provided the maximum opportunity to receive medical evaluation and treatment to ensure rapid recovery and return to duty. Be sure you lead by example and take care of yourself as well. Let me emphasize this point again. We are trying to change our Army culture here. It is not weak to get out or stay out of the fight when you've had a concussion. You'll be helping your teammates and yourself.
The Department of Defense is at the forefront of TBI research. The United States Army Medical Research and Materiel Command leads the way with comprehensive blast injury research. The purpose of the Blast Injury Research Program is to coordinate and relevant DoD research efforts and programs for the prevention, mitigation, and treatment of blast injuries. The program takes full advantage of the body of knowledge and expertise that resides both within and outside of the Department of Defense by leveraging new civilian and other federal blast research partnerships with DoD medical research laboratories. These achieve a cutting-edge approach to solving blast injury problems in full partnership with the Department of Veterans Affairs, the Defense Center of Excellence for Psychological Health and Traumatic Brain Injury, and civilian institutions ranging from major hospitals to the National Football League. The Department of Defense is committed to rapidly increasing our understanding of traumatic brain injury and improving our ability to diagnose, to treat, and to care for those affected.
All I can, you know, basically tell you men and women, again, from the bottom of my heart, from all three of us, we really appreciate what you do, not only for us, but for the whole world. And you have the utmost respect for me, and sure, definitely, from Ronaldo, definitely, and Dimitri, and just get it checked out. That might as well be our motto,
get checked, checked out.
In coming forward to change the culture, to move forward in science and technology, and working together as a team, for those to whom we owe so much, our warriors and their loved ones, there simply is no greater privilege.